like a bird in a nest, right? That at some point in the future is going to fly. Right? And what happens is that when it incarnates, now from that moment, it's now got individualization. It's now conscious of itself. You became conscious of yourself the instant you were conceived. And from that moment on emotionally, you began absorbing emotion. You began absorbing experience from the world around you. Now, many of those experiences in this world, this dreamlike world that we have around us, are very, very emotionally damaging, aren't they? And you absorb them. And I absorb them. Exactly the same. We're all under the same laws.
Babies born with defects, are they related to the
parents'
emotional state?
And its grandparents and its great-grandparents and like all of the emotional states historically get passed down generation into what's going on. The key is to not blame yourself as a parent. The key is to go into the emotion every single time. There's something going on inside of me emotionally. What's this triggered inside of me? Access that emotion. And actually, when you access that emotion to the point of oneness with God, you'll be just be able to heal your child anyway. Right? So, in the end, deal with the emotion that's coming up. It always gets back to that. Right?
Does it then affect the generations? If you have an understanding of the generational issue that's passed down, which we do in our family, and I'm having this intention to set myself free, does that then go backwards too?
Certainly.
As well as forward?
What happens is that let's say my dad like abused me violently as a child. And let's say my dad's passed now. So I'm now maybe in my 60s myself and my dad abused me violently as a child. Obviously I'm going to have lots of emotions to work through about my dad. And most of the time I haven't, because I don't work on these things a lot of the times all through my life. But let's say I decide to get on the divine path and I really want to work through these emotions. So I decide to work through them. As I work through them and I'm feeling about my dad, I will actually attract my dad in the spirit world to me. And he will have emotional responses to everything that I work through. And it will be triggering him as I'm working through those emotions. You follow me? And this can also occur in the real world, like when I say real world, our physical world. Like right now, you can choose to deal with these emotions without your parents if you want. But all that does is does half of the equation, really. My suggestion is to deal with it. Like if you're going to write a letter and not send it, that might sound well and good in terms of a healing point of view and trying to keep you safe. But in the end, it's not probably going to heal the underlying emotion. Send it. See what it does then. Speak the truth, send it.
The less damaged you are to someone sexually and emotionally, or say, and that you aren't compatible, in other words, you're attracted to someone sexually who you're emotionally incompatible with, that would largely relate to your emotional condition at that time.
Totally.
Or your injury.
Yeah. Remember, I think I mentioned in a previous group that the second chakra has a lot to do with all of your sexual attractions. The sexual chakra also has a lot to do with self-identity and unworthiness feelings. If you look at all the books and everything, that you can read all of these things quite easily. Now, you imagine that you have this injury inside of yourself. Let's say I'm a male and, in my case, have this injury with women that I'm unworthy of their attention. Right? So let's say I've got that injury. And there's a woman who comes along who feels dominant over men. And she's got that injury about herself in her second chakra. What's going to happen is our two second chakra points, if you like, in our spirit forms, are going to be very compatible, right? So there'll be a huge flow of energy. And a huge flow of energy will activate our sexual desire. So we'll feel very, very sexually attracted to that person, but we're both actually in a state of emotional injury. Now, when we release that emotional injury, we may not find that we're actually sexually attracted to that kind of person anymore. The soulmate relationship's not like that. So, you know, when we talk about soulmate relationship, we'll talk about something different. But the sexual attraction that goes on between two parties are usually to do with different emotional injuries affecting different parts of us. And they all come from our soul. All of these emotional injuries come from that part of us affecting these bodies. Right? So a man only gets an erection when he's either got some kind of sexual flow of energy going on, and usually that is because of some kind of either compatible emotional injury or there's a pure condition going on. Right? So, like I've found that after dealing with a lot of those injuries, I didn't have any sexual attraction to anyone until I met my soulmate. So I just could not even contemplate a sexual relationship with anyone until I met my soulmate. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And I didn't even feel that one. And my libido isn't. Sorry?
No, the feeling.
And it had nothing to do with my libido. It's got everything to do with what's going on inside of you emotionally and what kind of compatible injuries you have. But this is all part of this connection between the two soul halves, right? Remember that this is all feeling-based. Remember that? Passion, desire, emotion, feelings, intentions, aspirations, longings, memories, free will. All of those things are in your soul. That is the real you. Your personality is the real you. Not your body, not your spirit body.
So, when... Like if there's a sexual attraction, rather than hopping in the bed, you should go on that date. I'm just trying to,
yeah. Or you can hop in the bed and see what brings comes up. No, my suggestion is if there is a sexual attraction, you have two options, obviously. You have an option to enter into a relationship with the person, or you have an option to not, right? Now, most of the time, we have a habit of entering into the sexual relationship because of the strong draw that a sexual relationship brings. And then we regret our decision afterwards because we realise that there's a lot of other things at play that we weren't that happy with. Now, if that's been our pattern in our life, then we need to seriously look at how our sexual attractions are created. And so every sexual attraction you feel is an opportunity for you to heal emotions within you. Now, you can enter the relationship if you wish, and then go through the pain of the withdrawal of the relationship if you wish. That is your call. God's not going to stop you from doing that. You have free will. There are results from every choice you make. So some of that result will be pain, because you've entered a relationship not based on pure love, but because of other desires or other injuries. Does that make sense? And when you do that, of course there's going to be pain associated with that down the track at some point. So my suggestion is, if you feel a sexual attraction for somebody, allow yourself to look deeper at what's in it. Now, there are some very good books that can help you do that, but in the end, you're going to need to feel the underlying emotion that creates the attraction. And often, we're not willing to do that, because we're so drawn by this sexual attraction that we're not willing to actually now go into it emotionally and experience what emotion is driving us in this sexual attraction. So a lot of times, like I said, it will be a compatible injury with that person, right? And it's to do with our sense of self or our sense of masculinity or femininity that usually drives those kind of injuries. And they are all related to the interactions we had with our parents, right? So how many of you have felt you've just attracted your father, just in a different body? I know that sounds really bad, right? But a lot of times you notice that. Or you've attracted the opposite of your father. How many of you have done that? Well, it's the same emotional injury, you see? Well, what about your mother if you're a male? It's the same kind of thing. The reason why we do that is because we're unwilling to look at the healing of what's going on. So there's a lot of sexual healing. And it needs to go on.
He's sick.
I'm sick, you reckon.
Can I just ask a question here on this sex thing again?
Have I answered your question properly, though? Yeah? So you understand what's going on? So my recommendation would be look sincerely at the emotions that are going on inside of you before you jump in the bed with the person. If you jump in the bed with the person, there's a high likelihood that at a later time in the relationship you're going to go through emotional pain once you realise the truth. You can avoid all that pain if you deal with the emotions now. Look at everything as an opportunity to help you deal with the emotion that's driving the attraction.
But if you're a male and you jump into bed female, this is true, we can't think. If you're attracted to a woman and you're really attracted to a attracted to her, and it's happened to me. I just can't think. And I go, on all the stuff I've decided in the past, this wish list, and you can't even remember it.
And that's just a lovely excuse. Isn't it? I say it too. It is honestly, that is just an excuse, though, it is. Because there is an emotion driving everything that's going on inside of you. And so we can justify our own behaviour if you want. Like, I've sent out, and I don't know if any of you have actually received it, because it's something I did a couple of years ago, but there was a channeling I did where I talked, and it was tape recorded and then transcribed, where I talked to a man who called himself a manly man. He's in the spirit world.
Yeah.
Some of you have got that, yeah? And I'd be happy to send it out if for those of you want to read it. What happened was he was in the first sphere of the spirit world with exactly that, with exactly those feelings. But I'm a man. Like, I've just got to have what I've got to have, right? And he was having relationships with women after women, but not looking at the deep emotional injuries he had within himself.
It's not a decision thing, you just can't think. I can't think.
See, now you're not taking responsibility for your emotion.
Yeah.
You can. And it's not about thinking, it's about feeling. You follow me? There is something you're avoiding in your feelings. But the truth is, in the end, like, you will find that once you get into a pure state emotionally, you will only have an attraction for one other person. And that will be your soulmate. That's what will happen in the end. Right? And you won't be able to feel any other attraction. Right? And the reason why we feel all the other attractions is because there are certain emotions that we need to work through. Always look at that.
So, AJ, if you're aware of an emotional injury and you're not being able to come through it, am I right saying that the only way you're really going to fully come through it is with God?
Yes, but also realise that God has given you three tools, really. The first tool is your desire for truth, right? So that's why I said to seek first the kingdom. The truth will set you free. It's the truth that actually creates freedom in the end. So seek the truth. Seek to understand the truth. Set your intention for truth. The second thing that God gave you is prayer. Prayer for love, for divine love. Right? Prayer is not like these things where you sit down, you know. It is, prayer is a longing inside, a passionate longing inside of your soul for God's love to enter you. That's prayer. The third thing is God gave you the gift of humility, and you can choose to use it if you want. And what I mean by humility is the desire to experience every single emotion within you, whether it's painful or pleasurable. Right? Now, if you have just those three things, every single thing in your life, and it's that simple, every single thing in your life will be exposed. Every single thing. And you'll be able to heal it. Right? Now, a child can understand those three things. And that's why I said you need to become as a little child to enter the kingdom of heaven. Right?
So, this might sound a bit cliche, but I don't really understand how you actually pray.
And if you understand the soul, then you understand the soul is your emotional part of you. So you pray with your emotions. You direct your emotions towards God. That's how you pray. So you can talk if you want with that, but it's to do with the emotions that are inside of you. That is what you need to direct to God. So how are you feeling right now? Like, what's the emotion you're feeling right now? Do you know?
Confronted.
Okay, so I'm being confronted. So if I was talking to God about that emotion, what would I say that would connect me with this feeling of confrontation?
Sort of like an unworthiness feeling, like where I don't feel like he'd want to talk to me anyway.
Okay, so talk to God about that and let yourself feel the unworthiness while you're talking to God about that. And you'll find what will happen is some emotions will come up as a result. And that is your prayer. Your prayer is your desire. Do you follow me? So if my desire at the moment is this feeling of unworthiness, that is a feeling that I have within me, if I project that towards God, I just allow myself to feel that and be honest with that with God, then that's a prayer. And God responds to those prayers every single time. There's never a time.
I love you.
Not just by loving you, no. Obviously, everything is an expression of love, but God responds by also trying to help you through the law of attraction and through all of these other attractions and different things around you and spirits and everything. Try to help you come to understand that you need to firstly draw that emotion out of you, and secondly, this truth needs to pour into you. And God constructs everything in such a way that you learn that lesson in the end, as long as you're open and willing to experience all of your pain. Yeah. So the key is with all prayer is just to focus on the emotion. It's the emotion that is the connection with God. Yeah. Because remember, the soul is the emotional, passionate, desirous part of you. It's not the intellect. Right? Now you can utilize your intellect just like you can utilize your arm. Right? It's a tool that your soul has been given to help it along its way. But when your intellect becomes dominant, that's when everything shuts down. So it's no good sitting down with rosary beads, and I'm not here criticising a Catholic, I'm just saying, it's no good sitting down with rosary beads and counting out Hail Mary, Mothers of God, when there's no emotion. Yeah. Sit down and do that if you want to, but put some emotion in it. Yeah. Do you follow me? Yeah. Why are you saying these things to God? What's the feeling that's inside of you? That's what you need to connect to. When you have the feeling, it doesn't matter what tool I use. I can have a rosary bead, or I can have, you know, I can sit down in front and bow towards the sun or towards Mecca. I can do anything I want as long as I connect with the emotion. Right? If I'm not connected with the emotion, I'm not connected with my own soul, and I'm not connecting with God, and it's not a prayer anymore. All it is just some outward demonstration of my so-called faith, which I obviously don't have, because I am yet to have an emotional experience with God. Mm-hmm. You follow me?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So let yourself connect emotionally with God. That's what it's all about. Yeah. That's prayer. So let yourself do that. That's the feeling you're feeling right now, the unworthiness. Now connect with God about that feeling. You know, be honest about how that feels to God. Feel it. Yeah. A needy prayer is usually about an avoidance of an emotion. A longing prayer will never avoid an emotion. Now, let me give you some examples of that. Let's say I have a feeling of unworthiness in front of me right now. I have the feeling of unworthiness, but what's actually happening in my life is that I've got no money. Right? And I'm sick and tired of having no money, no matter how much I work. Like, I'm working my guts out all the time, maybe got two jobs, and I've still got no money. Now, my real feelings inside of my soul are that I want to have some money. Right? And I might project that to God, and I might even blame God for that. Like, I might say, you know, why is it? I try my hardest, other people don't. You know, they steal, they lie, they cheat, and I've got money, and I haven't got any money, and I'm trying to do everything right. You know, we might go down that track of feeling all of those emotions, right? Now, what we're really wanting is for God to do things our way. Now, if you're projecting something at God where you want God to do things your way, then that's a needy projection. So how many of you have prayed for a partner, like a good partner? Most of us probably have, right? Most of that's a needy projection. You see, because what's happening is God's already showing you that there's an emotion you need to experience that is causing you to not attract a good partner. Do you understand? Mm-hmm. And you're unwilling to experience that emotion. And so you're having this prayer to God for something that you're unwilling to deal with inside of yourself emotionally. So whenever you project something at God that's needy, God can't listen to that because it's all just about effects. I'm just trying to solve my effects. Right? And I'm not willing to look at the causal emotion. For God to listen to a prayer, I need to be addressing a causal emotion inside of myself. Or wanting to.
So what's the causal emotion with that?
With it wanting a partner?
Yeah.
It could be just a simple thing that I'm unwilling to feel loneliness. So the truth is I might be by myself being alone. I've now created this experience of being alone because I need to feel lonely. But I never let myself feel it. So what I do is I busy my life and go to this friends and that party and this thing and that thing. And I'm constantly looking for a partner in my life to fulfill me because I don't want to feel lonely. All I really need to do is cry for a couple of weeks about how alone I am. And when I do that and release that, ironically, after that, all the things that I think I wanted before then will all just automatically come to me because now I really do want them. Right? See, if I've got a lonely feeling inside of myself, what I'm going to create is a lonely life. Automatically. And until this lonely feeling goes in me, that's my creation. And this is something I want to talk about even more a bit later in our discussion. The problem is that all of us don't understand too well, and this applies to the world at large, that it's the emotion that creates, it's the soul that creates everything. It's not you physically, you know, doing something or intellectually trying to do something that creates anything. It's your soul's emotion that generates all your laws of attraction. Right? So it's the soul's emotions that you need to feel and experience and release. When you do, your law of attraction will instantly change. Instantly, from that moment, it will be different.
What forces carry out those laws?
God has placed, it's really God's intention, and we'll talk about intention a little later. God's intention is, and really all laws are God's intentions imposed upon his universe to control and make orderly his universe. Right? So what God has done is he's created all of these laws, and these laws operate on three different levels, and we'll talk about those levels in a minute. But the levels, the laws operating on those levels cause different things or cause different effects based on our actions. So I take a certain action, and by action I mean action at the soul level. Everything's soul. Right? If you can think of everything I'm saying to you, it's not about physical action, it's not about spirit-body action, it's about your soul's action. Every action at the soul level causes a response. If the action is in harmony with the laws of God, then our soul will be drawn along this path of God's intention, which is the power of intention. If the action is in disharmony with God's laws, then we're working opposite to God's intention, which means that every single law will be correcting us and we'll be feeling pain. So all pain is a result of actually us walking away from some of God's intentions, God's laws.
Are there any rogue, I've got this feeling sometimes, are there any rogue forces that operate outside of laws and that live, that exist between the physical, spirit world and the soul?
There are many forces, there are many people, both on earth and in the spirit world, who believe themselves to be outside of the laws of God. Yes. But none of them are actually outside of the laws of God. None. They just believe themselves to be. Right? And the problem is that every time you believe yourself to be outside of one of the laws, you're actually breaking the law. When you break a law, there's a penalty on your soul. When there's a penalty on the soul, eventually you'll feel some pain from that. So these people who are rogue, if you like, outside of the laws of God, what they're actually doing is creating more and more intensity of pain until such a point that the pain is so great that they stop doing what they're doing. And that's how it works.
Also feel collective pain. I mean, can you kind of tune into something that has nothing to do with you and then just try to feel that way?
You can always feel other people's emotions. In fact, all of you right now are feeling each other's emotions, right? Mm-hmm. You sometimes notice in the discussion, sometimes the emotion goes higher and higher and everyone feels more excited, and then I bring up a subject where everybody goes, woo, right? you can see the whole thing go depressed, right? That's because all of you are feeling each other's emotion, right? And interacting with each other automatically, being unaware of it. Now, you've often seen this in a room, like you walk into a room and the person right over the other side of the room just captures your attention. Why is that? There's something going on at the soul level. You walk in a room, there's no people there, and there's a dog there and he starts barking at you. What's going on? He's feeling something in you that is reflecting back at you. You follow me? So these things are automatically always happening. If you have an emotional feeling about it, then there is something inside of you that is resonating with that. Right? So you notice when some of the other people here express a little bit of doubt towards me, like, you notice sometimes you feel some doubt because of that doubt that's just been expressed, right? And then others of you don't feel that. So what's going on there? Well, obviously there's a resonance. If somebody expresses something and you feeling the similar thing, then they're just triggering that emotion. So in the end, every emotion does come from within you that you're experiencing. You'll get to a point where you'll notice everyone's emotion, but because it doesn't resonate inside of you anymore, you won't feel it. So one thing that I used to do a lot is, like, any woman that had any dissatisfied emotion inside of herself, aside from the sexual dissatisfaction, I would respond to. So in other words, you know, if they were unhappy with something, I'd try and fix it for them and so forth, right? Because I'm sensitive to that emotion. Once I've dealt with that emotion inside of myself, I can observe them having that emotion, but not feel like I want to respond to it anymore. Right? And ironically, in some cases, I've done that, and they've now become so angry with me they can't speak with me again. So what's that about? It's that they don't want to deal with that emotion. They didn't want to deal with the fact they wanted a man to look after them, and when the man wouldn't, what would they do? Just leave that relationship, whatever that relationship is. Right? So yes, you can feel everybody's emotion. Yes, if you experience it inside of yourself, if you cry along with it or whatever, then you're actually feeling your own emotional resonance with it. Now, how many of you are therapists? Right. How many of you have started crying when you're working on somebody? Yeah, quite a few, right? That is not their emotion. You are resonating with their emotion. There's an emotion inside of them that's similar to your emotion, and you're feeling your emotion. You follow me? So understand that. So their emotion is powerful. It might be a grieving emotion of a certain type. They're feeling that, and then you're resonating with that, and that causes the emotion to bubble up inside of you as well. How many times I've heard a therapist say, oh, I'm crying because of you. Like, you're not crying because of them. You're crying because your emotion inside of you is resonant with them.
So it's always mutual.
It's always mutual, yeah. And in fact, many of us who are therapists are in that mode to actually heal ourselves, to be honest. Yeah, most people, it's the case because there are mutual attractions going on.
I got a feeling, when I see someone fall over, I actually feel that pain. Or will they hurt themselves in some way, I feel that. What is that?
There's a feeling that we all are capable of having, and that is one of empathy with what's going on with another person. So, you know, like, we could sit next to each other and I can feel, oh, you've got this pain here or got that pain there. I can just feel a bit of a twinge there or whatever. Now, the reason why I'm feeling it with you is because of an emotion. So there's an emotion inside of you that causes you to be open to feeling it along with knowing it. So the way you're knowing it is by feeling it. You'll get to a point where you heal that emotion and you'll know they have that pain, but you won't feel it in your own body yourself.
I thought it was a part of healing. I thought if you could heal them, you've sort of taken that pain off them?
No. Why would you want to take... You know, many of us do this, by the way. Yeah. We do take the pain off of another person. But why would you do that? Mm. Isn't it a feeling?
Or you feel as though it's a...
Love would not create pain for yourself and relieve it in another. Love doesn't do that.
No.
Does God feel all your pain?
No.
So God doesn't take your pain and feel it all herself, does she? Right? Why doesn't she do that? Because it's not loving. We need to get that at least into our minds, right? And then eventually into here. That a lot of times what we believe is loving is not loving. And
I'm just wondering, if you feel like you have blockages towards certain emotions, like where you're just feeling, I'm feeling nothing, but you know that it's not complete, that it's just a blockage, how do we go about helping that?
And last week I did two discussions in Udlo and paid to have a look at those. The first one was a discussion about fear being your friend. All blockages are created by fear, generally. So there's something that's a deep fear that's within you that you're not allowing yourself to actually recognise and experience. The second part of the equation is understanding truth, and that was the second part of the discussion last weekend. So my suggestion is to get those two recordings from Peter, and you'll probably be able to then identify within yourself what might be the blockages to experiencing the emotion. The true state of your soul is like a child. The child does not delay its experience of emotion. Is that? You follow that, don't you?
Mm-hmm.
Right. So if the child doesn't do that, then eventually that's going to be where we are. Where we are going to be eventually is not stopping our emotional experience in any situation. If it's not flowing right now, it's because there's a blockage, and it's usually a fear-related blockage. So have a look at those two things, and then if you've still got some questions, yeah, bring those up.
AJ, with the prayer, it's like that longing for God becomes so intense. So instead of keep longing, I just feel the pain of what appears as separation. I mean, I'm trying to...
Yeah, if you're feeling pain in the longing... See, longing or desire does not create pain.
There's not a pain, but it just feels so intense. It's like why it's not complete.
Yeah, and the truth is life isn't. But, you know, so feel, there are inside of yourself, if I can deal with your issue specifically, there are some emotions of unworthiness that cause you to believe that no matter how long much you long for God, God is not going to answer you, right? And so there's some emotions that you need to let yourself experience about that. Let yourself feel those emotions. And it's interesting, though, and I know those emotions come up for you when you're praying. Right? And that's often the way it happens, is because we feel those underlying emotions and allow them to come up.
Yeah. I don't really have a reference to what God is or a desire to long for it. I feel like I have to get desperate for it.
You do have to get desperate for it. In a way, like, God created this quality called passion, right? Like, it's not the olden day version of passion, which was usually pain. I'm talking about this really strong, passionate desire within us. Now, passion activates everything. Like, desire activates everything in God's universe, including God responding to you. So at some point, each of us need to come to actually, in our soul, in this part of us, start having a desire or passionate longing for God. Now, we can do that without really knowing who God is at this point. One of the passionate desires we can have is actually coming to understand who God is. So that can be a passionate desire in itself. Now, if you had a passionate desire to understand God, what would you do? You would probably start reading lots of material about God, letting yourself feel as you're reading the material, what might resonates, what doesn't. You know, you probably read through the Paget messages, you read through channeled material that's about divine love, and you start connecting with God. Now, how many of you have attended these talks, and I know this is a pointed question, but how many of you have attended these talks, and I've talked about the Paget messages, and I've talked about Robert James Lee's books in almost every talk, how many of you have ever read a word of them? About half. So the other half of you need to ask yourself, are you really passionate? Are you really passionate about coming to know the truth?
Not yet, I guess.
How do you become passionate and how do you create a longing if it's just not there?
It's a very good question, yeah. And how many of you feel that you sort of like got an interest, but not, you know, just... Like, when you go home tomorrow, you'll get involved in your life and, you know, it might come up again next week or you might get an email from Grant and it'll come up then. Or, do you know what I mean? How many of you feel like that with your whole life with regard to spiritual development? How many of you feel like your spiritual development is your life? Right? So quite a few. Okay, that's really good. So how did you get from this one place to this other place?
Pain.
So for many of you, it was pain. Do I need to experience pain to be passionate?
No.
But often what happens for many people, as you can see in the audience, for many people, often what happens is they go through lots of pain first and then they realise they need to become passionate. So my suggestion is don't do that, if you can help it. Right? If you're not in a state of pain now, don't try and create one just to become passionate. The key is to start opening up yourself at the soul level. And you open up yourself at the soul level through desire. So it's only generating a longing in the soul that actually creates this opening up of the soul. And that's a longing for truth in the end. So I know you're here because you have a longing for truth. You want to know what the truth is. There's already a passion inside of you to know truth, right? So what you do is you find out all the things that you are passionate about, and then sit down with all of that and let yourself feel about how you generated those passions. And in almost every case, it was by you coming to know about it and then wanting to know more about it. And eventually that wanting to know more became a desire, and eventually it became a passionate desire. And that's how you generate passion in the end. So it doesn't come from apathy. We can't just sit down and wait for passion to enter us.
Do you need to focus on that feeling of that wanting, reaching out for God or whatever?
And reaching out for truth even if you don't believe God exists really at this point. Even the longing for reaching out for truth. Just say to God, look, I don't really believe you exist really, right? So be honest. I don't really believe you exist, but if you exist, bring me some truth, because that's the thing I'm really interested in, right? And see what happens. Start having a longing for that and see what happens. And in the end, you'll find God responding. And let yourself feel those responses that are going on. So how many of you are not firmly convinced God really exists? Would there be quite a few? Yeah. Okay. So how do you ever know whether God exists? Well, firstly, this is where the truth sets you free. Right? It's not God setting you free, even. It's the truth that sets you free. Because when you start having a longing for truth, then all these other things come to you. So just try setting your intention. I want more truth in my life. I want truth in my personal life. I want truth in my emotions. I want truth about the universe. I want all of this to come to me, and I really want it, and I really want to start getting some passion about that. And then see what attraction happens after that. Just notice the next week what happens to you, what emotions are coming up, and you'll see there is a response. Right? And the key is then to build on that response that occurs. But if it's not pure from your heart, then there will be no response. So that's one of the laws of God, in fact.
Can I ask a question? It ties in with what you're saying, and it's a part of the toing and throwing I do in my own mind. Part of the psychology of rulers is that if you can get the peasants to worship a god which emulates their ruling patterns, they will subconsciously accept you. In other words, if you get the peasants to have a god, if you can control the god, you can control the peasant. That's how it happened forever.
Yeah.
So, basically...
Which is the basis of most religion.
Yeah. And so how do you not become a religion? How do you not become part of that? How do you not become political? This is what I'm saying. It's the most puristic of movements have become Masonic, if you like, just turned into a structure of control.
Yep.
How do you prevent, on a personal level, that happening with what you're doing?
You mean, how do I personally prevent that from occurring?
Yeah.
And I don't want control. So whenever anybody tries to get me to control something, I just reject it. So, it's not in harmony with love to control you. What's in harmony with love is to give you the gift of truth and for you to decide what you're going to do with that. So what I'm encouraging with each person, and this is the same thing for yourselves eventually as you're growing, if you're encouraging people to be dependent upon you, then what are you encouraging?
It's like the Catholic Church of your previous life. I mean, that emanated and attached itself and became a form of rule, and every attempt that the original doctrine was posed to. And that's one of the saddest things. If you attach faith or passion to something, you can very often forget where you originally started.
Yeah, well, let me address two things first. Firstly, your emotion. Your emotion is there is a deep fear inside of you regarding religious control. And that's an emotion that you will need to let yourself work through and release. The second thing is that what I'm promoting is your relationship with God, not mine. I want my relationship with God, and what I'm trying to do is encourage each of you to have a personal relationship with God. You do not need a mediator. You do not need somebody else to show you it, even, in the end, except for maybe some basic principles about emotions and the soul and all those kind of things. You don't have to listen to a word I say in the end either. Right? Because you have free will too. All you need do is connect with God and have a desire for God's truth to enter you. God answers you. If there is a God, don't you think she's going to answer you? If there's no God, she's not going to answer you, right? Isn't that quite simple? If there is a God, she'll answer you if you're sincere. If there's no God and you're sincere and you don't get any answers, then obviously there's no God. try it out and see. You know? So with regard to your relationship with God, though, like there's nothing, I don't want to accept any form of power or control or anything like that. So how could anybody formulate anything around me with my approval?
Well, it did after you died last time.
Was it with my approval? Why did they do it, and why did they do it last time?
Those who rule have to control the belief systems that they've done.
Exactly, and what am I asking you to do? I'm asking you to buck every system and connect with God directly. That's what I'm asking you to do. That's what my life was like in the first century and what it's like now. And that's what I'm asking you to do. You don't have to, but that's how you connect with God, by actually connecting directly with God. And when I say buck every system, I don't mean that every system will need to be destroyed. Every system will be incorporated in it. Like, there'll be lots of different religions, for example, that in the end they'll incorporate the principles of divine love in them, and they'll all be on the path. At the moment, many of them are not, because they're not incorporating the principles in them. So my intention is not to create another religion. My intention is to actually form this same principle in all religions. That is, this is how you connect with God. Connect with God this way, and you will feel God. When you feel God, you will know what I'm saying to you is the truth.
And I have to say,
it's the only way.
I feel in every single time, AJ, I feel deepened gratitude, and it just gets. I've searched all of my life since I was 3, when you came and saved my life, and I feel gratitude that what you say is so loving and so empowering for all of us. And for me as a person.
Yeah.
And every single time I've seen you, from the first time in the DVD, that enormous gratitude. So thank you.
Thanks, Jen. The key is that if you think of it, in the end, all I'm trying to do is encourage your personal power. Right? And I'm showing you where your power exists, that's all. Now, you don't have to believe a single word I'm saying, and in fact, I have no emotional attachment to you believing. You follow me? To be honest, if none of you rocked up today, I would have just gone and had some fun with Mary and... I don't need you to respond, but I'm here because I love you. And I want to tell you the truth that, you know, that has been a part of my life, that's all. And you don't need to even respond to any of it. You don't even need to agree with any of it, even. But I can guarantee to you, if you follow it, your life will completely change. How many of already your life has completely changed? That's a lot, isn't it? How often does that happen? Just through learning some truths.
Brought us here, then the desire for truth is there, isn't it?
Exactly, yeah. So trust your law of attraction. You got this guy in front of you saying he's Jesus, just trust your law of attraction. He's obviously bonkers, and you need to have someone bonkers to trigger you, right? Or he might be Jesus.
Okay. I suppose a doubting Thomas is coming here, but I'm not doubting. I'd like to know this. We hear and read and understand karma and the karmic laws.
Mm-hmm.
This is a bit personal for you.
Mm-hmm.
As Jesus, and I've not met you before, and so I'll just believe that this is who you were. Being brought up a strict Catholic, but understanding the Bible, whether the Bible's right or not, I'm not sure. The life and death of Jesus as we know it, believing that maybe Jesus was the perfect being and that we should try and aspire to be like Jesus. This is my question to you.
Yep.
You as that person, why do you have to be incarnated, reincarnated, still with shit, karma?
Well, if you understand soul, you'd understand all those questions. On the DVDs, on the CDs that I just gave you, there's a 100-page document explaining the answer to your question. So my suggestion, have a read of that, and then if you've got more questions, ask me about it then. that all right?
Yeah,
yeah.
That's cool.
But the document will explain a lot of those things. And the truth is, I'm subject to exactly the same laws as you are. So when I reincarnated, I was subject to exactly the same laws of emotional assimilation that you were. When you incarnated, what happened to you? What happened to you was you were a pristine, unblemished soul. When you incarnated, from the moment of conception, when you incarnated, you started absorbing emotional injuries from your environment, right? And that's what's created what you have now, this combination of pure desire and emotional injuries mixed up all together inside of you right now, right? That's what's there. And it's exactly the same for me. I've just reincarnated, but at the moment of conception, my new bodies and my new physical and material bodies start absorbing these emotional injuries. In my case, because there's a lot of memory-based experiences, all of my memories are getting filtered through those injuries. 2,000 years of memories, actually. So it is no different, except that you don't have the 2,000 years of memory, that's all. That's the only difference between me and you. Right? And obviously I'm in a different state from a love perspective, because of already, once you receive divine love, you can't lose it, but you can forget it. But you can't lose it, ever. And you'll find every little bit of divine love you receive, you'll never ever lose it the rest of your life. Ever. Once you receive some, you can never lose it again. So my suggestion, again, is just to have a read through those explanations. If they resonate with you, then let them. If they don't, then we can answer more questions. There is a whole discussion, by the way, that I have on reincarnation, which is, again, another discussion like this. And we're getting away from our soul discussion. And I really want to get back to our soul discussion. Now I know it's hard to stay on one subject with me sometimes, right? And all of these different thoughts and feelings come into your mind. But my suggestion is write down some of these questions that you have, right? And then, and perhaps, you know, we can answer them in just one question and answer session or something like that, rather than sort of interfering with the discussion that I want to get. Because this discussion will answer many of these questions as to how all of these things occur. Right? Now, it might be time for a break, do you think?
Yes.
Yeah? So we'll have a break and then we'll come back to this discussion. Now, of the material that we've just that I've given you, we've covered basically pretty much the first page of stuff. And although not in the order and sequence of which I probably would have. I don't want to at this stage spend too much time on some of the other things, because they're just facts really in the end. And rather than giving you facts, what I would like to do is help connect emotionally to a lot of this material. So what I want to do is just talk a little firstly about the law stuff for a moment, which is the start of the second page. But then I want to talk a lot about setting your intention to progress, what soul progression really is about. And we'll speak a lot about that. And that really I'd like that to be the next part of our session. What I would like you to do with your questions from now on, if you can really focus on staying on topic, all right? And because if you don't, then this discussion will be a half-baked discussion that we'll have to continue at another time. And I'd really like all of you to come to the understanding of what your soul really is. Right? And it's so important for you to understand that your whole life is governed by your soul. It's not governed by what you think you're deciding to do. It's actually governed by your soul and the choices you have made at the soul level, which are the emotional choices that you are making. Right? So many of you at the moment have a feeling in you, for example, that you're unworthy. Right? That you're unworthy to connect with God, for example. That unworthy emotion, right, is actually creating things. It's creating things around you constantly to trigger itself. Right? And that is your true soul. Now you can tell yourself, and many of you I've noticed are telling yourself things like, I am worthy. I am worthy. And isn't that just the same as the affirmation thing,
yeah.
You know? Like just going for a jog and saying you're worthy. In the end, you want to get away from that and you want to go into the truth. Right? It's the truth that connects you to God and to yourself. So go into the truth. So what is the truth? The truth is I don't really feel worthy to connect to God. The truth is I need to experience some emotions about that. I need to cry about that or feel about that. Do you follow me? That's what I need to do.
Yeah? Do you always have to cry?
Well, it depends what emotion is. But if it's grief, yes.
But there's other ways to release an emotion apart from crying?
I love this question. How many of you want there to be another way? There ain't no other way. Well, anger is covering over. Anger is not a real emotion. Anger is a covering over, a suppressive emotion that's covering over things. Remember that your true soul emotions, all of the things that heal your soul are about grieving. Grieving is the healing emotion. It's about letting go of all of the things that have happened to you over your life and actually letting yourself experience the things that you've tried to not experience.
Say if one of the causal is unworthy.
Yep.
If you do things that you have fears or phobias against, and you actually do that and put throw yourself in there, is that a release of the...
It can trigger the release, but it's not the release. Like the release of emotion, there will always be a shift inside of yourself that you will feel. And you will get to a point where you don't have to try to do it anymore. It just happens automatically and you don't have any negative or resistive emotions towards it. So understand that if you release a causal emotion, the law of attraction just changes instantly, just like that. Like it's instant. From that moment on, you won't have to... Like for instance, I dealt with an emotion about money. And the instant I dealt with that emotion, I started receiving funds. I've done this, this going around travelling all around the world, talking to groups like yourselves. I've done that for the last nearly 6 years now. It was only up to 1 year ago, I hadn't had a single person come up and thank me. So I've been doing it for free. And I hadn't had a single person come up and actually really give me a feeling that they had a heartfelt feeling of thanks.
Thank you, AJ.
I'm not saying this to get one from you now. Why didn't I have that? Because I had an emotion inside of me that I needed to release where I felt that people were thankless. And it took 5 years nearly of living with thanklessness before I allowed myself to experience that emotion. The instant I allowed myself to experience that emotion, now many of you have already expressed your thanks to me and some in a financial way, some in a giving way, some in providing accommodations, all sorts of different ways, right? Now that's happening all the time, but only after I dealt with it emotionally. You follow me? My soul was attracting thanklessness. Right? A similar thing happened with regard to my interrelationships with women of all types. I was finding that I was just attracting these needy women that wanted me to keep giving and giving and giving and giving and expressing myself and helping them feel like they're loved and all those kind of things. But in the end, they also wanted to try to control me. And then in the end, I'd stop them controlling me, and they would then get angry with me and run away and say, look, AJ's a bastard, and, you know, he's not very nice at all, right? And in the end, it was all being triggered, an emotion inside of me of my willingness to allow a woman to control me. Right? What I had to do is deal with some deeper emotions within myself. The instant I did with that, all of the women within, who were around me who were doing that, within 1 week left.
All their excuses.
Sorry?
All the excuses are they giving?
Oh, all sorts. Yeah. Most of them are angry with me because I had changed. They said I had changed. And my answer is, I sure have. I through have changed. I'm now no longer going to accept. But look, many of them thought, like, we would have time together and they would then get angry at me and swear at me. And instead of just saying, getting up and walking out, what I would do is I'd sit there, take all their anger and swearing, give them a hug and say, oh, I'm sorry, you know. And eventually they'd connect with the underlying emotion. And then I'd talk to them about their anger, nice and patient, all these other things. And then, lo and behold, a week later, what would happen? Another issue would come up that triggers emotionally. Yeah. And what would they do again? Same anger, same response, same thing. Not learning a thing, right? And the instant that I dealt with that emotion that caused me to keep doing that, they all left. So what I'm saying to you is, if you deal with the emotion, everything will change instantly around you. Your soul is the true thing that is guiding your life. Your soul is you, the real you, not the fictitious you, the bit of you you want to hold on to in here, right? Not your definition of you. It's what you really are. So if you're angry with men inside of your soul, that is what you're putting out the universe. And you know, your young son who comes and screams at you occasionally is telling you that. You follow me? It's the soul attractions that are keeping on hammering you. And they're saying to you, you have these emotions within you right now. This is what's guiding your life. It's not what you think is guiding your life. You can make as many intellectual decisions as you want. Nothing is going to change until you feel the causal emotion inside of you. So, get back to the soul. What is the soul?
Yeah.
So let's get back to the soul. Here's my soul. All right. What part of it is me? It's the passionate part of me. It's the emotional part of me. It's the desiring part of me. It's the intentional part of me, the part that intends things. It's got free will. And this little thing here that we call a body, and this other little thing here that everybody wants to work on in the spiritual movement called their spirit body, right? So we're talking about the physical body, which you could call the material body, and the spirit body. They're just appendages of you. Why work on them? Why go along to these constant forms of therapy and all these kind of things if they're not helping you emotionally? Right? Because this is the real you. This is the bit that you need to focus on if you want to have a relationship with God. It's what's in here that matters, and some of what's in there is truthful, loving, honest, open, and some of what's in there is fearful, judgmental, angry. And you need to release that bit and choose to release the bit that is causing the resistance within yourself, and stop focusing on this metaphysical stuff. Do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Stop focusing on the metaphysical stuff.
When you have a physical ailment, is that, I know it'll be an emotion you chose not to deal with.
Yes.
But does it just pop up in your body randomly, or is it specific to where it pops up?
Yep. Every physical ailment you have is a total reflection of soul condition things that you're holding on to, and each soul condition emotion affects a certain part of your body.
And have you written stuff on what different organs represent?
And I don't need to, because there's so much material already written about all of that.
But which ones are accurate?
Well, all those that concentrate on the emotion generally are more accurate than the ones that concentrate on the mind or the intellect. Right. So a lot of these things over the coming years will all be updated and sorted out. But at the moment, if you can go back to this every single time, you've got a pain in your body. Who's got a pain lower back right at the moment? Right? Unworthiness issues. Right? To do with self-love. Right? Who's got a pain across their chest at the moment, feeling a bit of asthma, maybe tight chest? Grief. You need to cry. You need to do a lot more crying.
Stomach, spleen, liver.
All to do with fear. Right? A lot through here, all to do with fear, right? Eyes, not willing to see my problem, not willing to see the big picture.
What about kidneys?
Kidneys, not off, I can't tell you off the top of my head. Sorry?
pissed off.
Stop. And a lot of anger-based emotions come out in your skin. So you'll find itchy skin, like hives, you know, eczema, those kind of issues, often related to suppression of anger, which is a suppression of grief, really.
Blood pressure.
You
should write a book on it, AJ.
There is a book written on it. I think I've got it in here, actually. No, I haven't. It's called The Body is the Barometer of the Soul. I've told you about it already, I think.
Yeah, pretty accurate.
A lot of it is very accurate, yes. But remember with all this, all right, I read the book. It says, yes, I've got a problem there with my, you know, feeling tight across my chest. It's to do with sadness. Does that help you?
No.
Because what do you need to do? You've got to feel the sadness. So in the end, knowing where it is slightly helpful, but is it actually going to help you connect with it all underneath? Not unless you're totally willing to experience the emotion. So you need to get back into this. This is the real you. Every time you deny the real you, you are not loving the real you. Do you follow me with that?
Yeah.
So you can look after and nurture this body all your life. You know, you can pop a few pills in it to make it feel better today, and you can go and get a massage here and whatever there. But if you're not dealing with these emotions, you are not loving you really. You're just creating a false sense of security inside of yourself. To love you really, love your emotions. Love the feelings that are in you. All of them, painful, pleasurable, don't select them. Feel them. Express them. It's only the unreleased emotions inside of you that will come up. Do you follow me? Like every emotion inside of you is either an emotion that you're feeling either right now, or it's an emotion that's been frozen in time in the past that you've not allowed yourself to feel, right? Set your intention to feel those emotions. Right? So let's talk about that.
Well, what if you continually cry over something? You know, like something has happened, and every time you think about it, you just get upset.
There's either one or two things going on. Either it caused a lot more pain and you just need to cry more, or you're not realising a truth yet, not accepting a truth. Right? So, for example, I had a lot of emotions about over the last sort of... I can bring up a few examples. But I'm not sure how one member of my audience might feel about them. So what we'll do is, I think, is bring up some other examples.
She can leave the
room. The one example I'd like to bring up, though, is this issue with regard to money that I had. Right? What happened was that I had an inherent belief. Like, when you're in the spirit world, you can see everything that's going on as a background behind money. So you can see all of these evil groups of spirits influencing the monetary systems of the world, controlling all the people in power, and the people in power are not the voted people.
No.
Right? They are. It's all a facade. And you see all of this happening, and what you see behind the scenes is this huge group of spirits and people on earth that are the core drivers of all of your financial systems. All of the financial systems that are wrecking your life, basically, are all created by these people to create fear and control.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, as a spirit, you see all this operation in operation, right? So I incarnate. After seeing all of these things in operation, I incarnate. What's one of my highest emotions? Is money and all the systems behind it are just evil.
Yeah.
Right? That's one of the biggest, big emotion inside of me. So what is that going to generate in my life?
Money issues, anger.
Of course, money issues, of course, because what am I feeling? Money is evil.
Yes.
Like, so anytime I get a piece of paper in my hand that looks like some money, it's evil. You know, there's this emotion that I'm not experiencing with that. You follow me?
Yeah.
Now, a few weeks ago, I was talking to one lady, my law of attraction, and I could feel she had the same emotion in her without... And this is the thing is, many times you can feel someone else's emotion better than your own, right? And you'll find this the case all the way through your own progression. And then so nowadays what I do is I reflect back on my own life all the time. All the time. So I'm asking myself, why did this lady call me? it's because there's these issues and that issues and there's some childhood issues and child fragmentation, all those other things, and none of that connected with me, resonated with me. And then I got it, right, that she's got some very large issues with money. She's going totally broke, this lady. And I could feel that her father was a part of this UN monetary system. And he actually would speak to spirits in front of her. He would speak to the evil spirits in front of her who were controlling the US these monetary systems. And they would actually strategize what they're going to do next to actually take money off of people. Worldwide, I'm not talking about on little measures here, I'm talking worldwide governmental systems. And because of that, from a very, very young age, she has this huge emotional injury regarding the father, the evil part of the father and what he was doing, and money and all of those kind of things. So whenever she just feels about money, she just feels this terrible dread and anger and so forth. So she rejects it. And once I realised that, that was my law of attraction going on there, because I had the same feeling in me. I released that. So I cry about that. I released that. I must say, I cried about it. There was like feelings of grief about that, because I know all of these systems in themselves are not the problem. The problem is the intention that all the people have behind them that creates all of this evil, right? But inside of me, I had this automatic association. Evil money, evil money, evil money. Release that, and all of a sudden I start receiving money. Right? And that happens automatically.
But right? Those who create the money only do it to get power. So money's illusionary, it's just a means.
It's a total illusion. And in fact, the world we'll have in the future won't have money. But at the moment we're going through this transition phase where people like yourselves are coming to see the truth about all these systems.
Well, the same people who are inventing money are inventing a future where we go about money and possessions will be held in the banking corporate sector and be administered.
Yeah, no, I'm not talking about any of that. All of that is just going to all die.
Yeah.
A whole lot of that's going to die. Yeah, and there'll be world events that will occur that will create that, that will make that die. And you'll see this all happen in the next 5 years or so. It'll just all just pass. I do that in my emotional clearing discussions. So we're getting off the soul again. We'll have to talk about that in another discussion.
Just still focused on the soul, however, with respect to the New Age adage of higher self or crystal self or different things like that. The perception and feeling is like there is some part of us which is extremely intelligent, extremely wise, that we try to want to bring in or tap into. The impression I get from you, a soul is all of these. I don't see or feel that there's a huge, vast intelligence or anything like that in the soul. Is that wrong?
This is where the only intelligence is.
But is it how vast?
See, as soon as I start talking about intelligence...
Yeah.
And wisdom. Knowledge.
Yep.
Virtue.
Sorry?
Virtue.
Virtue is a quality, is more of a soul quality. But these things are more coming from this intellectual desire to understand.
Yep.
Right? But all those things are automatically when we get these in harmony with God. All that's automatic. That's what I meant by seek first the kingdom and all these other things will be added to you. So at the moment, many of you are still wanting to understand intellectually, wanting to get things, wanting to be knowledgeable and work wise and all those kind of things. Give that up. What we want is just to be like a child, isn't it?
Yes.
Don't you just want to have fun?
Yes.
Isn't that what it's all about here?
Yes.
Like, and after a while having fun, you know, all of these things will come to you. You'll work out how everything works really easily and you won't have to study it either. You'll just feel it. Oh yeah, I feel that. That's a new truth. Wow. Like, you didn't have to learn it from any other source because you got taught it from God through your emotion. Right? So what you will need to do, and the desire to get into this is all about still the desire to understand. Right? That comes from an emotion. I don't understand. Feel it. Feel how useless it is to intellectually try to understand things. That's an emotion the majority of us have, right? We want to understand because we actually feel we're quite dumb in the end. So feel that. Feel that emotion. When you feel that emotion and you no longer have that emotion that you're a dumb idiot anymore, what will happen is that you will automatically have all these truths come to you and you'll realize the power of yourself, realize the power of your own soul. That makes sense to you?
Yeah.
All right. So every time you focus on this part of you, you are getting off focus. You're getting off focus from this part of you, which is the real you, right? Every time you want to understand everything, do things intellectually, you're getting off of this, right? If it's about fully experiencing this. That's the real you. That's the part we always need to focus on. Every single thing in your life, every accident you have, every illness you have, every emotion you have, every law of attraction you have, everything that's going on in your life is created by that. Your mind had nothing to do with it. You might think you want to have something to do with it, but it's too bad. You only have something to do with it at that level.
So, does that mean that our life is predestined?
No.
In that sense? Like...
No, this is your soul. Nobody else's. It's your soul where you either retain emotion inside of you that you don't want to release, that's your free will, or you release it. And it's just by the releasing it or the retaining of it that creates your reality. Right? You have total control over that reality. Nobody else does. God is saying to you, I want you to live your life. That's why I gave you the gift of free will. I want you to do exactly what you want. But whenever you want to do something that breaks some of my other laws for the harmony of my universe, there's going to be some kind of pain in your soul. So if I'm feeling pain, I've just broken some laws or I've broken some laws in the past that I'm not willing to deal with. That's all. Right? I just don't want to become aware of them. So how many times do we get some pain and then what do? Go and get an aspirin. Huh? But what's that doing? It's just saying like, oh, I've got some pain. It's not emotional. It's got to be to do with the body that I've got, that God gave me. He gave me a crappy body, come to think of it. Because it's getting all of this stuff, you know, happening to it. But in reality, I just created all that. And I'm not accepting that truth. You follow me? If I'm not accepting this, I'm not accepting all of these truths. And if you focus on this truth, everything in your life will change. Everything. So, you know, all the secret stuff, you know, how they say, you know, set your intention, write down a picture, have a mental image, all those kind of things. It's only going to work as far as it affects this. So if it affects that, it'll work. If it doesn't affect it, it won't. That's why for some people who've tried it, how many of you have tried the secret stuff for the last 5 years? And it hasn't worked for you on some major areas.
Lots of areas.
Lots of areas, right? Yeah. And the reason why is because it's not focused on the soul. Right? It's focused on... Oh, I better pick up my piece of paper. It's focused on this part of you, you know, trying to create something with the intellect. Mm-hmm. Yeah? The soul is the real you. It creates everything. And you are your soul. Like, a lot of people say, are you the reincarnation of Jesus? I'm sorry, no, I'm not. I am Jesus. I just happen to be reincarnated. My soul is the same soul that it was all the time. Exactly the same soul. Your soul will never change. Aside from growing, I mean. It will never change. You won't become another person just by reincarnating at some point in the future. You won't become another person. You will still be your soul. This is the real you. This is the real you. Not any of this, yeah.
In the introduction, you know how you got like God's children and this cluster of souls just all together. Are they sitting in a specific spot in accordance to planets, or are they just in a general spot they all sit in, and they just go to different planets around the universe?
But again, you're thinking very physically, and the question is like we're talking about the soul, and now we've got onto a question that's about your intellect again.
Yeah.
Do you see that? Can you see? What you're trying to do now is you're trying to understand some physical things about the intellect, about the soul. But in reality, when you let yourself feel your soul, a lot of these answers will come to you automatically and you will not need to ask me. It'll just come to you. Bang, bang, bang. How many has that happened to you already? Where you've had a question one day with me, you didn't get the chance to ask it, you allowed yourself to sit on it emotionally, you let yourself feel, you connected with God about the question, and bang. You realise, I know what the answer is now.
Or somebody else asks the question.
Or somebody else asked, or whatever happened, right? Why does all that happen? Because it's happening all at the soul level. Right. So the question, although like a valid question, how does it help our discussion at the moment? I can give you the answer. It's in there actually. But
I know, just part of my nature is really.
So let's go into the nature of you. Your nature is to understand things here before you allow yourself to feel them here. That's the nature. That's the area that if you can do the most work on that, that's what's going to help you understand all things. You understand what I'm saying?
So what would you suggest to do if you're very mind-oriented or you're seeking wisdom and knowledge all the time?
And yeah, there's no harm in seeking wisdom and knowledge. Firstly, let me say that. There's no harm in that. But if it's taking me away from this, now there's harm.
So I should ask, why is it taking me away?
Well, the question firstly is, why do I want wisdom on it rather than just feeling it? Why do I want to know about it rather than experiencing it? See, here's the experiential part of us. This is the part of us that observes the experience.
Yeah, because I feel like I learn best once I have all the facts and I'm observing something.
No, you don't. You actually learn best when you allow all your emotions. That's the only time you learn something.
So you really talk about pecking order, aren't you? Because one's a product of the other and the other's a product of the other. So it's just a means of obtaining information. It's like if you... I believe in logical intuition. In other words, I'll get intuitiveness about something and then I'll intellectually fill in the space.
Exactly.
People try to intellectually create something and then identify it backwards.
Exactly.
But all knowledge comes through the soul.
All true knowledge.
And only pieces it together in word format so that other people can understand it.
Exactly. All true knowledge comes through this method.
Yeah.
All through this method, not through this. When we're focused on this, we're trying to get away from this because there's emotions inside of us that say, I can't feel until I know what I'm going to feel. How many of you are afraid of what you're going to feel, so you choose to not feel? How many of you are afraid of what you're going to feel, so you need to know first what it's going to be? How many of you have actually come up and asked me, what emotion do I have inside of me? And my question often comes back, why do you want to know? Why can't you just feel it? Like, I can feel your emotion, so why can't you? You know what I mean? The reason why you can't is because this thing's going on all the time. Get away, you need to get away from this thing and back into this thing.
So do I need to have a really massive emotional breakdown to make that, to bring me down to the...
No.
I'm going to ask you why you asked that question. But can you see the motive behind the question? What's the intention behind the question?
Knowing something.
You want to know what it's going to be like before you do it. That's the only motive behind your question. Right? Many of you want to know what all this divine love stuff's going to feel like before you do it. And you know what? I can't tell you any of that, because it's only going to be what it is for you when you begin experiencing it and feeling it. You follow me?
But with our soul, because that's God-given, isn't everybody's soul beautiful, wise, and radiant, and it's then a lot of, depending on what we've gone through in life, it's being buried by all of our negative emotions?
Totally. So, but why is it buried by negative emotions? Because the emotion is frozen in the soul. Remember, emotion is energy in motion, not frozen. When we freeze the energy, when we freeze the feelings, what happens is all of our experiences are created around that frozen emotion. So let's say I'm unworthy with women, right? So what am I putting out there? I'm this great big antenna saying out to the world, I'm unworthy with women, treating unworthy all women, calling all women who are willing to treat me unworthy, right? And so what happens then? Like, of course, this emotion's going out. Now, intellectually, I'm not saying to myself, I want to be treated unworthily by a woman. What am I saying in my mind? I don't want to be treated bad. I'm worthy. I'm worth something. I'm not, you know, this is the things I'm telling myself. But the emotion is there, saying something totally different to the universe, not just to the next door neighbour, to the universe, right? And while that emotion is within me, I'm going to attract the long lineup of women who want to hurt me, right? And they want to do that because it triggers my unworthiness even more, because that's the thing I need to experience. When I choose to go into the experience of feeling the unworthy emotion fully, I will no longer be going, treat me unworthy, treat me unworthy. I'll be actually saying to the world, I'm a worthy man, and to be with me, you're going to need to treat me pretty well. But it's not going to be an intellectual thing that I say. Right? And this is a problem with all movements on the earth. They all say all these intellectual things. But what they try to do is they skip over all the emotions and say, this is what is going to be in the end. The feminist movement is a movement like that, really, in the end, isn't it? It's a backlash movement based on the bad treatment of women that they now, we're now saying all women band together, we're going to, you know, have affirmative action and affirmative rights for us being treated right. But the only way you're going to be treated right is to release the emotion that you have about being treated badly. When that happens, automatically the people around you will change. Just like I described earlier, around the people around me changing, all automatically the people around you will change, and the people who are going to reflect your true emotional condition at you will be attracted into your life. This is the power of this.
So if they emotionally heal, I don't have to use awful political correctness.
Why would you bother? What is political correctness in the end? It's just words in the end, isn't it? It's all just words. Yeah. But this is why you need to involve God in the process. Because the truth is, if you do it without God, yes, you will be spending a long time of your life. There's been spirits in the spirit world that has taken 2,000 years of your time here on earth to get from a place in the first sphere in terrible emotional condition to the sixth sphere, which is the perfected emotional condition of the natural man. They've taken 2,000 years. With God, there's been spirits that have taken 9 months to get from one location to the celestial spheres, which are two spheres above the sixth sphere. Right? Just by focusing on the real self, getting real about themselves. Right? So the thing is, involve God in the process. Now, many of you, by involving God in the process, will have a huge overwhelming emotional feeling about that you're unworthy for God. And, you know, all those, let those emotions come up, cry and grieve and experience them. Let yourself experiencing them. Everything you experience will just lead you closer to God. Yeah.
So if you can solve your problems with God, will that solve your problems with others?
Oh, totally. Totally. Yeah. See, what God's trying to do, think of it this way. When you interact with another person, you have emotional injuries and they have emotional injuries. So they will have emotional injuries in receiving love, and they will have emotional injuries in giving love. And you will have emotional injuries in receiving love, and you will have emotional injuries in giving love. So that introduces four areas of error straight away in your relationship. You see that? So straight away, I think I'm trying to give love, and it's not really love. I'm wondering why she can't receive it, but the thing is she doesn't want to receive that kind of love anyway. And then she's trying to give me love, but it's not really love. And I'm trying to receive this love, but I'm not really feeling it's love. Right? And you've got all of that going on all the same. Oh, it's very confusing. Isn't it? Right? Now, let's look at it a different way. Let's say I connect with my Father, with God. God doesn't have an injury with giving love. And God doesn't have an injury with receiving love. So any time you're not feeling God's love enter you, it's because of your injury. Not hers. That makes sense, right? So if you're not receiving divine love into your soul, it's because of an injury inside of you. Don't condemn it. Don't punish yourself for it. But go down the track of just feeling it. Feeling what the injury must be, of finding it. Setting your intention, and we'll talk about intention now. Setting your intention to find out what this injury is and experience it and release it. Yeah? Once you do that, experience it and release the injury, it will no longer define your relationship with God. And because you've now healed that permanently in your soul, it's no longer to define any of your other relationships either. Right? So the beauty of working through everything with God is that God doesn't have these emotional injuries that you have or that your partner has. if you choose to work through all of these emotional injuries with another person, you've got four sets of emotional injuries to deal with. If you choose to work through your emotional injuries with God, you've only got two sets. They're all belonging to you. We're how you give and how you receive. Right? Just two sets of emotional injuries. And the beauty of that is that you know exactly where you're at any one time. So, like, if I'm not receiving the flow of divine love that I've recognized within myself, I can feel it as an emotional experience, and I'm not receiving that, then I know I've got an injury. There's a reason why I can't receive that. There's a blockage I'm putting up. I'm basically saying to God, no, 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 no. You want to give me your love your way, but I don't like your way. That's what I'm really saying to God, right? I want it to be my way, thanks. And by rejecting God's love from flowing, this emotion is going to be exposed at some point. If I choose to set my intention to find out what it is, if I notice that God's love's not flowing through me, and every time I'm not reflecting that love, it's not flowing through me either, and I notice those occasions, that's all I need to do. But it gets a lot more complicated if we try to sort it out with a person. Right? So, example. Let's say you're alone right now and you're hanging out for a partner. Right? You know, when that partner comes into your life, you're going to find that it's going to trigger you on a lot of emotional levels. Right? But some of those levels are going to be their problem and some of them are going to be yours. And how are you going to work out which one's which? Now, the way to work it out is, firstly, work through your own issues with God. Work through those issues so that you can receive and give love. And you can feel it flowing out of you, feel it entering you. You can feel God's divine love entering you. And as you do that, automatically, you will heal all these areas in your soul. And the law of attraction will bring you the people to trigger those emotions. So, like, I never had a relationship for 5 years. And no, I didn't get horny the whole 5 years.
I'm at a portal, don't look this way.
No, I can there's automatic questions popping up in her mind and I can anyway, so I have to answer them. But but what happened was that the reason why I didn't feel that sexual attraction was because those emotional injuries had been healed, right? In the sense of as to why I was looking for relationships that weren't my soulmate relationship. But that doesn't mean I didn't have a lot of injuries to still yet to deal with about the soulmate relationship, right? But for that 5-year period, I attracted woman after woman after woman after woman into my life on a friendship basis who continued to, as I explained before, try to boss me around and dominate me and all of those kind of things, right? And I didn't enter relationships with them. In the sense of sexual relationship, all I did was allow them to trigger the emotion. So in one case, every time she was angry with me, one lady who travelled with me for a few months, every time she was angry with me, I'd go in my room and cry. Then I'd come out, give her a hug and say everything's all right. And then she'd be angry with me again, and I'd go in my room and cry again. And then I'd come out again, and everything's all right. And then, what am I not learning here? I'm a very slow learner, as somebody pointed out last time. Right? What I'm not learning is that I have this deep emotional fear, obviously, of acting upon this unloving treatment. Right? And I wasn't learning to actually now do something about. So I was having my cry about the effect. She was treating me badly, and I would cry. So I was crying and releasing the effect. But the cause wasn't being connected. The cause was that I was allowing this continual treatment of anger, 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 because I felt unworthy of having any other treatment. Now, once I felt that emotion, which took about 3 days, and I experienced it in Greece, and once I dealt with that emotion, automatically, I could not deal with one more moment of this same lady doing the same thing.
Mm-hmm. So how did you behave then?
I sat her down and I said, I won't say her name, but I said to her, if you keep treating me in the manner in which you're treating me, I am going to have to withdraw from you. Because how you're treating me is actually very unloving. And I actually sat her down and actually told her the reasons why she was treating me as well. I listed those group of five emotions that she had, core emotions, that I listed down for her, and we're in a discussion. Now, she found that discussion quite easy at that time, but within a few days was in a state of really rage with me, and she will not speak to me now at all.
So she doesn't face that?
Well, she hasn't faced the opposite injuries yet, and I'm pretty certain she will at some point. Right? But I'm getting back to my own situation. My own situation was I was willing to keep on going and keep on going and keep on going in this situation forever, really, until I had the realizations and the emotional experience of why was I letting myself continuing to be treated in the manner I was. Not intellectually, and there was an emotion, and I needed to connect with that emotion.
So at what point in time do we just accept us? You know, said this like in the face, like where is that? That's after you've gone through all the...
After you, yeah, don't try to jump to the end without experiencing the emotion in between. All of us attempt that at some point.
Well, people say that we should accept whatever's coming to us and...
But accept it in the way that, emotionally, accept that it's come to me, what's it triggering inside of me, go into that experience. Go into that experience. Because what happens is that I can accept it intellectually and say, Jesus said slap me in the other cheek and it's fine. How many of you really feel that? How many of you, after the first slap, just want to punch the person back down? Yeah, the eye for the eye, tooth for the tooth, right?
You said it.
No, I didn't. I didn't say I offer an eye tooth for tooth ever. Right? The truth is, at the end, you'll get into a condition, right, that you will be able to cope with anything for anybody, and it will not resonate with you. But let's get truthful at this level first. At the moment, you get hit. How do you feel? How do you want to respond? Really? No, don't do all the spiritual mumbo jumbo and all the, you know, things of trying to cheer yourself up and all that kind of stuff, and then go down the road of telling yourself that it's really all right and you understand they're in a bad place and all that. Go into your emotion. How do you really, really feel? Isn't it most of the time you feel, that was unjust? No, I didn't deserve that. You know, you feel like, you know, you get really hurt in your heart. Feel that hurt. Feel it. Feel what's going on. Experience that hurt. Release it, connect to the childlike feelings that are going to be underneath it. Connect to those and release those. And you know what? There won't be another person who wants to come up and hit you at all. So I went through this really long phase of almost every single person getting angry with me. I'd have groups like this, and I'd start talking, and because I'm truthful at the start about who I am, half the group would just project all this anger at me, get up and leave. It was quite good after that, because everyone that stayed was a bit more open emotionally. But what I would feel was this huge wall of anger and hatred just being whacked on me, right? And it just triggered all of these emotions that I'd go home usually and have to be cry about for the next week. And then I'd go through the emotion of, oh, why bother doing this? You know, this is just a thankless task, and which was another emotion, another cause of emotion I had to work my way through. What's the point of, you know, helping people that don't want to be helped, and all those kind of emotions. But now I feel totally different to all of that because a lot of those emotions have been released.
Does that mean you're attracting different people now?
Totally. Yeah. Well, all of you can feel each other's spirit a fair bit here, right? Mm-hmm. You don't feel too much resistance here, right? Do you?
Wow.
Right? Now, the first meeting we had here in Brisbane, like a couple of weeks ago, there was a lot more resistance, wasn't there?
Yeah.
You could feel that, couldn't you? Right? Can you feel that obviously something's changed? So something in the law of attraction has changed. What's that? It's my law of attraction.
We did send them an email.
Because the same people got the same message that their group was here, but now just different people come along, right? And the reason why is because as you change at the soul level, things automatically around you change. That's automatic thing, right?
Actually, I'm worried that I cry about the effects and don't get to
it. It's a common problem, and we have a whole discussion about cause and effect and how to identify causes with effect. But just briefly, when you have a feeling of peace afterwards and can feel the divine love flow into you when you ask for it, that usually means you've just dealt with a cause. if you go into this state of just still feeling bad and still feeling bad and crying the next day, crying the next day, crying the next day, and the law of attraction keeps bringing you the same events, you are not dealing with the cause. You're just dealing with effect. So in the case of this lady, the interaction with myself, you know, she over a period of about 6 months or so, there must have been 10 or 12 times where she was screaming, swearing at me, pretty much, like. And I would sit there and take it. So what's my law of attraction? It's telling me I haven't dealt with the cause, right? And I'm still having the same, I'm crying about the effect. So every time she does it, I'm crying about the effect. I'm not trying to project anger back on her, which is okay, which is better to not do that. But I still wasn't connecting with the cause. Yeah. But we'll talk more about that in the whole other discussions.
Part of that, like you sort of say, you cried for 5 weeks, and the question was like, how do I know if I'm dealing with cause or effects? Do you know, like on Monday, I have been crying about the cause or the effect, or do you have to wait for 5 weeks of crying to know? Well, actually, not
I don't even bother asking myself that question.
Right.
And the whole reason why you're asking these. Sometimes, but then it came up the next day, so I know I haven't finished it. So, you know, I know I've let go of a little bit, let go of a little bit, let go of it, and then eventually I got to the finish where I let go of the cause. And you'll find the same. You're not going to be able to have one release and everything's fine. Right? Anybody who tells you that, they just don't know about their emotional work, really. You're going to have do many releases, and eventually you'll be fine. The law of attraction will tell you when it's fine. Your law of attraction will change. I don't want to have any more questions about this now because I want to talk about this intention thing. Yeah. All right?
Yep.
It's really important. Here's your soul. Here's God. God has created this universal structure of law. You could call it God's intention. In other words, everything that's happening around you is the result of your emotional condition mixed with God's intention. And if your emotional condition is against God's intention, right, and if it's against God's intention, in the end you could say it's in disharmony with love. So if your emotional intention is in disharmony with love, it will create negative or painful effects in your soul. If your emotional intention is in harmony with God's intention, in harmony with God's laws, what happens then? Everything just goes really smoothly. So it's when, has anybody read the book by Dr. Wayne Dyer, Power of Intention?
Mm-hmm.
There are quite a few of it. Okay, one thing I like that he says in there, there's a few things I like he says in there, actually, but one thing that I like that he says in there is that when you talk about intention of your soul, we're not really talking about the power of the intention of your soul. We're talking about the power of the intention of your soul matching the intention of God's soul. So see, when your soul's intention no longer matches God's intention, you are now bucking against the system. And when I say the system, I'm talking all of God's beautiful laws, which are based on love, you are bucking against. Right? So that's like trying to push a wheelbarrow full of rocks up a hill. Right? That's what it's like. You're pushing against the law, against gravity. Gravity of God's intention is there's God's intention, and when I align my intention with God's intention, that's when there's real power. That's also, I suppose you could say ironically, when there's also pure happiness. The same thing applies. So intention isn't this thing, the intelligence and the knowledge, forcing yourself down a road. It's not that, right? Intention is far different to that. Intention is when your soul's power, your soul's emotion, matches the emotions of the universe, you could say, or God's emotions, right? And when the two match each other, you'll find your life will just fall into patterns. Now, all of you at some point have had the experience where little bits and pieces have fallen into line just really easy without you doing anything, right?
Yeah.
How did that happen? It happened because at that moment your passion and your emotion and your intention matched God's. That's how it happened.
Yeah.
Right? And as soon as it doesn't match God's, now you're on your own. And when you're on your own, then everything's like pushing uphill.
Examples of like where
Okay, just a very brief, simple example. Let's say you come up to me and you want me to hear your story. So let's say you start telling me your story of your life. My feelings are, this person wants to tell me a story about their life. What's their aim? Now, in most cases, their intention is that they want me to commiserate with their story. Do you understand? They want me to understand. Now, you're placing quite a huge burden on me, actually, because every person that meets me wants me to understand, right? And how many people are there in the world? And then how many people are there in the spirit world? And I'm meant to understand them all. Is that what you're asking? Because that's really what you're asking. Can you see that? So what's the intention? What's God's intention? God's intention is for you to talk to God about your emotion. That's God's intention. You follow me? So when you come up to me and I reject your intention, what do you feel?
Unworthiness.
Unworthiness or pain, or you feel angry with me or whatever else you might feel, right? But all that is just exposing that you've actually done it out of harmony with God's intention. God's intention is that you talk to her, right? God's intention is to allow you to communicate firstly with her, right? So that's just one example. My soulmate doesn't feel that's a very good example, but it's one example.
I just wanted to ask you about desires, because I was very surprised to see it there on the soul. Normally, you know, people talk about letting go of your desires.
All this talk about letting you go of your desires is allowing the intellect to take control. And God doesn't want you to do that. God wants you to have your desires. Why would he create a sexual desire and then say, you got to let go? And then create, you know, desire for love and then say, oh, you got to let go. And desire for all these other things. A desire to give, oh, you got to let go. Like, why would God create desires and then want you to let them go? That doesn't make much sense, really. Right? What we need to do is to connect with our desires in harmony with God's intention. So, yes, God created your sexual desire. Do you think God also created you to have the sexual desire so you just have sex with everybody and anybody?
No.
Why not? Well, you've got free will. You can have sex with anybody and everybody if you want. It's not in harmony with love. Do you see what I'm saying? It's not in harmony with love of yourself, because it's not what you truly want at your soul level anyway. And it's not in harmony with love of others, because there's this temptation then to hurt or harm others. And what do we see? We see results of that are disease, particularly sexually transmitted diseases and so forth. All of these things are the results of the disharmony. Just telling you it's not in harmony. God allows you to do them, but he's also telling you the results of the disharmony in the process of doing it. So in that case, if my desire matches God's desire, there will be no disharmony in me physically. There'll be no disharmony in me emotionally. There'll be no disharmony in the other person that I'm interrelating with. If we're talking about sexual desire, there's the other person whom I'm having a relationship with, there'll be no disharmony with either. They will feel completely happy and I will feel completely happy, and it's totally in harmony with love. If it's not totally in harmony with love, then one or both of us will start feeling some pain about it. So desires are really important. In fact, there is a law. God's created a law of desire, and every single thing in your life actually is governed by that law. Lots of your attractions. So, you know, I've been talking a lot about the negative attractions, I suppose you could call them, of the soul. I don't believe they're negative, because every attraction of the soul is there to release the emotion. But when we're going through it, we believe they're negative, right? But all of those attractions are there because of the desire of your soul to clear itself automatically of all its error. Everything's about desire in the end. There's all these beautiful laws that when we understand them from an emotional perspective, that they all make a lot of clear, crystal sense to us. But notice in this section there that I said that intention is not setting your mind at something. Do you know what I mean by that? Like, how many times are you told, you know, create a mental space and a mental image? It's going to be okay if you do it with that, emotionally. But many of us don't. We just sit there and just imagine for a while, there's no emotion in it, there's no emotion in it. While there's no emotion in it, nothing will be created. It's only when there's an emotion in it that something will be created. And it has to be a pure emotion. Right? If it's not a pure emotion, then it will not be created. So you can tell yourself all you like that you've got a pure desire to have a good relationship with somebody. But if right now, right at this minute, your relationship is not what you imagined it to be, then it wasn't your pure desire in the first place. It was a desire of your soul to actually expose its emotional injuries, creating this relationship. So work on that. Yeah?
So if you set your intention towards divine love along the divine path, will things just evolve? Will relationships evolve?
Everything will come to you. Just everything. Everything will come to you. And I've listed there some things about what the intention is. So that's why I've said it's from the soul. It's emotional. I've said it's humble. In other words, it's willing to experience all emotion. Every single time you decide to select your emotion, you are automatically detuning from intention. So every single time you want to feel good and not feel bad. How many of you do that on a daily basis? Got a list of all these good. To render, prayer, choice, faith, trust. Read those definitions there and think and just allow yourself to ponder about them because they are all a part of your intention. But without your intention, without you setting the intention, God's laws can't act with you. You're acting against God's laws if your intention is out of harmony with God's intention.
AJ, can I just say something?
Yes.
Sorry. I just feel it's really powerful to highlight that your intention, if you set your intention towards just growing, your soul's growth, you don't have to worry a lot about God's intention because you're setting your intention to grow. Mm. And through that, you're going to experience your emotional error and injury and you're going to release it and things will naturally come into alignment.
Mm.
If we really focus on what is God's intention, what is God's intention, it's almost like we skip over. If I just want to be humble and experience my growth, then
yeah.
I'm going to get to God's intention.
Yeah, and in fact, God's first intention for you is to experience your emotion.
Yes.
So that's the first thing to understand about God's intention, is that her first intention for you is to be emotional. Well, you look at a child. Isn't a child emotional? So God's intention for you is to be emotional. Right? Every time you detune from your emotion, you are detuning from God's intention. But like Mary says, you don't have to think about what God's intention is in any one case. All you need to do is be humble and experience all of your emotion and set your intention to do that. Because that is in harmony with God's intention for you. Yeah? Okay.
When a person's intentions and desires are the same as God's, is that when they become one with God?
Eventually what will happen is all of your intentions and desires will be in harmony with God's intentions and desires. It doesn't mean that you won't have your own feelings and your own thoughts and your own passions. What it means is that every feeling, every thought, every passion, every motive you have within you is in harmony with love.
That's what I mean.
And once that's the case, then you're at one with God. Yeah. And you'll feel the one with God occur. You actually go through a process of actually understanding your own immortality as well. And so that you feel that transition occur. And it's a transition that occurs after lots of emotional work, initially.
Is that also when you receive the divine love? And when you receive the divine love, you always have it? Is that right?
Each portion of divine love you receive, you retain and you'll never lose it again. But receiving divine love is like an ebb and flow type situation. I release a bit of error, I receive a bit of divine love. I recognise another truth, I receive a bit more divine love. And that keeps growing and growing and growing as it might go over a period of a year or 2 years or whatever, till eventually I get to the point where there's no more error. And once I get to the point where there's no more error, I go through this transformation of the soul into the divine. And that's what I call the new birth or being born again. And like in the first century, I spoke to this man, Nicodemus his name was, and he was a religious leader in the Pharisaical movement. And I said to him, don't you understand what it means to be born again? And the truth is that most of us don't understand what it means to be born again. And what it means is to go through this transition, this slow transition of growth, until we get to the point where there's now no longer any error and there's only truth in our soul, there's only divine love in our soul, and when we reach that point, we will physically feel a transformation inside of us. Right? And many of you will choose to experience that transformation here on earth. And when you do, you will understand what it means to be born again. Because it's only when we experience it that we understand it. Yeah?
And will stuff still come up, but it will just be with it in a different, easier
way? Nothing will come up that will be painful in your life ever again. Nothing. You can't be at one with God and experience pain. You just don't. Nothing will come up in your life that will ever be painful again. Now, a lot of people feel like it's just utopia. And I'm not. This is reality. This is God's reality. Just not ours yet. Yeah?
Is it true what it says in the scriptures that there will only be 144,000?
No.
That will have that potential?
No.
Thank heavens for that.
Yeah. The reason why is because God is not partial.
Just a point to sort of try and fit together what you've been saying in my mind, perhaps you know, somebody else's. Say if you meet an opposite sex, say woman, and and you find that there's a really strong attraction you have for that person. But at the same time, you can see a lot of faults in that person that's going to lead to an eventual sort of fall down. You know, which way do you go? Do you go with the fatal attraction that you know is always going to take you on a journey, going to lead you to imperfections in yourself which will allow you to heal, and she's going to have a good man, you go on your way to perfection? Or do you say, oh well, I'm fatally attracted to you, that's from the unborn court, you're a bitch, and I'm getting out of here. Which way do you go?
What's motivating the question?
How deep is thy love?
Can you see what's motivating the question for you there?
Okay.
Just look at what's the underlying emotion that's going on inside. Like what's going on is you want me to make rules for your behaviour.
No, I don't want any rules.
Yes, you do.
I just want the interpretation of your philosophy in relation to which direction would you go. If you're
interpretation of my philosophy. I ain't telling you nothing. None of this is my philosophy, okay. For a start. This is all stuff that God has taught me. So it's not my philosophy. It's God's truth. Now, you can take that or leave that, but that's what I'm saying. The second thing is that I'm saying you can have that connection with God and you will know the answer of what to do in that situation automatically without having to ask any other single person around you. Now, oftentimes what we are led by our erroneous desires. Our desires that are based on error. And, you know, if we're led into sexual relationship after sexual relationship after sexual relationship, we are being led by a desire that's not in harmony with love. Look at your intention. Mary said a good thing that I've written down here somewhere, and I'll just find it for you. Oh, true morals come only from love. Depending on intention, the same actions may be loving or unloving according to what motivates them. So in answer to your question, if you are, look at your motivation, you may find your motivation is just to get horny and get off.
It's what?
Your motivation might be just to get horny and get off sexually, right? In other words, to actually
have... Look, that's always a part of you, honest with yourself, that's a part of everybody's emotion. A part.
No, it's not. No, it's not. This is one of your erroneous beliefs. And the truth is that it's not a part of your emotion. The truth is, look at the intention. If my intention is just to have sexual fulfillment without love, then my intention is not in harmony with God's intention. My intention isn't loving. Now, sure, you can make the choice now to go down that road if you want. And you'll get some resulting pain. And that pain may shock you or shake you into getting into a different place. Right? But it depends on your intention. Your intention may be to have a sexual relationship with this woman to heal sexual problems within yourself. Now we're talking about a more loving relationship. Where you're now loving yourself and you're loving that person, you know, in terms of at a deeper level than just having the sex. So most people have sexual injuries, right? You know, we're taught terrible, terrible things about sex, right? Many of you will need to work through those sexual injuries. How do you think you're going to do it without having a sexual relationship? You're not going to be able to do it without having a sexual relationship, right? But if you're just having a sexual relationship just to have sex, and you're not having a sexual relationship to work through all the emotions involved with it, then your intention is obviously, in that case, not harmonious with love.
No, so what I said, I'm a part of everybody's intention when you have. I don't know if you were a teenager, that was over 2,000 years ago. But you know, when people are getting this powerful biological pull that you're saying that you have, and therefore part of your intention, part of what you do would just be the lustful part, and it has to be.
See, we're always coming from our emotional injury perspective. Always. Because we believe the emotional injury is the truth. The truth is that every single child who's ever born, if they did not have any sexual emotional injuries related to sexuality, by the time they're 6 or 7 years of age, they would have met their soulmate. And by then, they might even be having a sexual relationship with their soulmate. Right? Now, I'm just saying the truth. Now, it might trigger you, like children mucking about with each other sexually triggers you, then that's an injury you have, right, in the end. Because in the end, a lot of these things are to do with injuries, right? So what we're talking about here is look at the intention behind everything, what's going on. What's the feeling going on behind it? You know, if I'm trying to justify having a sexual relationship with people without there being emotional content, without there being something going on emotionally, then what I'm trying to do is just justify my own horniness, which is actually just justifying lust. And there are literally billions of spirits who have passed into the spirit world who are now in the first sphere, still justifying their lust.
Billions.
Yep. You know how many people on earth say, like, a prostitute is a bad woman and all this kind of stuff? Honestly, there are far more people who pass over in the spirit world in worse condition than any prostitute who's ever passed, who have never been a prostitute in their life, right? But they have deep, serious emotional sexual injuries that cause them to continue to lust and lust and lust and lust to their own detriment. Right? It's a huge emotional injury that affects all of the world today. So the key thing again is to get back, what is the intention of why I want to have this relationship? Is my intention to heal stuff within me and to help this lady or man heal stuff within himself? And is my intention to focus on all of my emotional injuries? And is her intention to focus on all of her emotional injuries or his? Is that our intentions? See, that's a loving relationship, no matter who it's with.
Because it's honest.
Because it's honest. And it's also truthful and it's exposing my soul, which is any base relationship based upon my soul and the love for my soul is going to be a good relationship, even if it's a temporary one. Right? If I don't have that viewpoint and all I'm doing is having sexual relationships so that I can get this feeling that I have of sexual dissatisfaction, like satisfied, then all I'm doing really is just fooling myself. I need to go into what's this emotion driving this? Right? What's my intention? This is where your intention can be like totally different for the same situation. So I could get a fat person up here next to me and say, "Did you know you're fat?" just to embarrass her. Couldn't I? Now, was my intention in harmony with love? I've just broken a law. I've broken a law of love just by my exercising my intention in that way. But I can actually talk, a woman might ask me, "Why am I fat? What's going on?" And I can talk about those emotions within her that cause her to create the weight being put on, and that can be a loving act. Right? Can't it? So, on one hand, my intention was to harm, and on the other hand, my intention was to help, and yet the action was almost identical, right, exposing her condition to herself, right, in each case. So do you understand the difference, like how much difference intention makes?
Yeah.
It's a huge difference, isn't it? Mary said another thing, like the intention behind the actions and not the actions themselves should guide your conduct, right? So you just think about that for a moment. The intention behind the actions should guide the conduct. So, like, when you go out to get an ice cream, what's your intention?
Comfort.
All right. Now, if we're trying to comfort an emotion, is that loving ourselves?
No.
So straight away, my intention is in disharmony with love of myself. Do you see that? Now, I can still go out and get an ice cream and it be a totally different intention. Now, the truth is the majority of us eat because of our emotional intentions to satisfy these emotions within our soul that we don't want to feel. Right? And that's why we eat. You, like, women period time, you know. Chocolate, women period time. You know this, right? Why is that? There's an emotional intention. There's an intention to avoid an emotion. Isn't it? And you can do it, that's fine. God says, no worries, just put on a bit of extra weight for the next few days and have to take it off during the month, right? And you can keep salving, or you can keep calming down your emotions by doing this. But in the end, it's not going to bring you closer to God. My suggestion is do the opposite. Set your intention to expose your emotion. Right, to actually focus on this part of you.
AJ, what would be a loving reason to go and buy an ice cream? What would be a loving?
You're asking a question from a guy who's never eaten ice cream in the last 5 years. Do you think that's a good idea? And in today's environment, if I look at all of the intentions that I would have regarding ice cream, I couldn't validate myself having one. Now, that's not... Like, last night, myself and Mary had some soy ice cream, and that's totally different. But milk and the different things that are happening on the earth today because of milk are terrible. There's some terrible things happening to animals in particular, but also to humans, as a result of this huge promotion of the destruction of God's creations. And I couldn't, in my own heart, set my intention to do that. Yeah. But again, what you set your intention to do is up to you. What I find is every time I had it, and I used to, you're talking to a guy who used to get a 4-litre container, get a knife and cut it into four, and eat a litre at a time. That's what I used to do. Right? And what was I doing that for? To cover up lots of emotions with a big sugar hit, right? Which I loved. And I'd then pour, you know, chocolate or caramel syrup or whatever the top. That was my idea of a lovely meal. So, do you understand? Like, now my intention is to love my soul first. And ironically, when you love your soul first, all your body sorts out all of its issues. You start losing weight, everything just falls off. You'll eat the same food. You won't, you know, and sometimes you'll change the food because of the love that you don't feel is in there anymore. And you will just change your intention and suit your intention. In each case, go through the emotions and release them. And in the end, everything around you will change because of that. So set your intention to do this work. Really set it. Many of you at the moment are still playing with it. You follow me? You're still trying to have an intellectual argument as to why you should do it. All right? And why do you want an intellectual argument? Because this soul's screaming out to you saying, no, don't go there, don't go there. Right? It's saying, I don't want you to go there, it's too afraid. So deal with some of those fears. Yeah?
But wouldn't the soul really be saying, I really want you to go there?
No, because the soul has emotions that are erroneous as well within it. Remember, the soul is a combination of the true emotions and the false emotions, right? When I say false emotions, I'm not saying they're not real emotions. I'm saying they are error-based emotions. And so So, you know, the problem is the soul has this combination of emotions. So one of the emotions that is in your soul, it's a belief deep within you, is a fear, a huge terrifying fear about what it means to be emotional 24/7. How many of you feel afraid about what's that going to do to your life? Yeah. It's going, like, many of you feel it's going to ruin your life, don't you? And I'm saying, no, it won't. Actually, it will actually make this beautiful life. But at the moment, there's a belief inside of you saying, no, AJ, no, you're wrong, really. Right? There's no way, no, I'm feeling your emotions like that. It's going to create a beautiful life for me. You know, I'm going to tell my husband that I don't really love him most of the time. What's he going to feel about that? And my answer is, he needs to feel his emotions about that. And you need to feel your guilt about that, right? And then I might tell, you know, I might tell my job, people at the job, go stick it because I don't want it anymore, right? And then, you know, what will I do? I'll be broke. Yeah, so you need to feel about that too, you know, what it feels like that you feel like nobody cares about you and nobody wants to support you financially and all those things. There's all these emotions we have locked up in us, and we do all of these things over and over again to calm them all down, to suppress them, really. Right? And all we're doing is nursing our little inner child, saying, there, you don't have to feel that. You don't have to feel that. Right? That's all we're saying. And the truth is, what's God saying? Yes, darling, you've got to feel it. That's what God's saying. Yes, my son, you've got to feel that. And it's the choice that we make, this intention, the setting of a choice that we make. Instead of calming ourselves down and making us feel all secure, what we need to do now is let go of all this stuff. And in the end, we will feel totally secure, totally calm, right? But it won't be a manufactured state anymore. It won't be something I've got to try from here anymore. It'll be from the heart. And what I would like to do is just read a channeling to you. This was a channeling, and I must say, though, the person who channeled it no longer believes that what she channeled is correct. Because the channeling had information about it in the channeling about me being Jesus, and she no longer agrees with that statement. Right? So she's gone through some emotions about that, and she feels that she can't agree with that. But I find this channeling really beautiful channeling. It has very little to do about me, so that's why I find it so beautiful. And so let's look at the question that was asked was, why are so many on the divine love path having such a hard time emotionally and not progressing much? And Beatrice was a celestial spirit, still is a celestial spirit, whom I met about 2 years ago when she was in the first sphere. So she progressed from the first sphere to the celestial spirit spheres in 9 months of our time on Earth, after learning these truths. And then she came and channeled this information. And this is what she said. Well, firstly, they are not fully choosing. They are intellectually choosing, but not choosing with their heart and their soul. Then they often have preconceived ideas or notions of how this emotional path should be for them, and this cannot possibly be helpful to them. An emotional path towards love and the truth of God has to be one of trust and faith and allowing, surrendering to everything, working, feeling on a soul level, without the mind influencing that flow of emotion towards God, which is your personal journey that is unique, quite unlike anyone else's. Until this is fully experienced on a soul level, the law of attraction operates in all sorts of ways to distract, creating difficulties and additional emotions, because there is no clarity from within, from the soul level, remember? From this level, right? Once a person has chosen fully here, the path is clear, the distractions fall away. There are no additional difficulties, and it could then be said that it is plain sailing in many ways, of course very emotional plain sailing, towards the full desire that your soul is calling for. But until that time, that moment of fully choosing, this cannot happen, and further difficulties will continue to be created by your soul to attempt to show you that you are not fully committed to your chosen path. You are sending mixed signals out from your soul, and your soul creates further mixed signals for you to experience. So how does a person who says, but I'm really wanting to be on the divine love path in totality, but then finds themselves stuck or in continual anger, for example, change things? Interestingly, the lady who channeled this is now in continual anger with me. So it's an interesting thing. Because this person is, I am sure, intellectually stating that they are really wanting to progress. This is a dilemma that in many in the spirit realms experience. As simply as possible, the best way to explain is to say that you have to want everything. Every single experience, painful and beautiful, ugly and extreme, in every way, to become a part of who you are. To so want these changes that you give up all those things you know will hinder your progress. To have such a strong desire that you can feel the pain of that desire on every level of your being. So that the desire is so strong in you, you feel propelled. You have no choice. There is just surrender to trust and faith, because you, your soul, is yearning for that love and truth because it's always been there. It is there, it is simply hidden, clouded by the damage from all those years of being out of harmony with the truth and love. Know that this is all within you to reach, to heal you, to become who you really are, to see the truth, to feel love and greater levels of beauty that you can have no comprehension of as yet. Why would you linger? I can say to you now, from my reality in this magnificent celestial kingdom, words cannot do justice to the beauty, harmony and love that surrounds us all, and it just keeps getting better and better, more and more intense, beautiful. So why wait? I would have loved to have been given this knowledge while I was still in the physical. To have been without divine love for all that time now seems a waste. And dear, that's why I choose to help you and many others through you. This really is the most remarkable journey, and I am in gratitude to you and A. Jesus for your part in my discovery of a path that is quite exceptional. I will do all I can to help you, all of you who now call on me. I love you with all my soul, each of you, and I encourage you to find that deep place within you for the full choosing that is simple once you have done it. It's a nice message, isn't it? Yeah. You can see though, with regard to fully choosing, I'll be glad when I get rid of these classes. Got to fully choose that one too. All right, so yeah, with regard to fully choosing, it's so important to understand that it's about experiencing the pain and the pleasure, right? Experiencing everything. And many of us are not prepared for that yet. So just pray to God about that. Long to God about connecting with everything inside of you in reality, not avoiding it. You follow me? Don't avoid what's there inside of you, no matter what it is. Yeah?
Thank you. Over the last few years, emotionally and spiritually, it seems like there's been so many changes. On the other hand, there's been so many operations that have come through, and my vision gets worse.
Yeah.
So I can't reconcile. It seems like it should get better.
And
the level I'm changing.
Yeah, the key is there are certain causal emotions that create certain physical infirmities in every person. Often what we're doing is we're releasing this emotion and releasing that emotion, and often we start with the emotions that are easier for us to deal with, right? So we start with an emotion that's quite easy for us to deal with. When I say easy, at the time it doesn't feel easy, it feels overwhelming, because every new emotional experience is an overwhelming experience. We just grow. But eventually we get to the stage where we can deal with some really deep causal stuff. Now, everything to do with operations and physical problems and injuries that we have and all those kind of things are all to do with emotions that we are yet to experience. Right? So the key is, don't get down about it. Or if you are going to get down about it, at least talk to God and have a good cry about getting down about it. But let yourself start working through and seeing what those injuries would be. Ask God to show you them. So instead of saying, oh, you know, I've got this particular problem, I need to take that particular pill or have that particular operation, let's go down the track of asking God, firstly, what is this emotion that's creating this? Now, you can take the pill and have the operation. That's all your choice. but ask firstly what the emotion is. It's always going to be an emotion that creates everything in you.
When you said haven't experienced the emotion yet, does that mean we chose not to fully experience in the past and we haven't fully experienced it, or that
that's right.
Emotion that we need to...
That's right. Every emotion that's locked up in you has been frozen in you because it wasn't fully experienced at the time we needed to. And the problem is, for many of us, is when we were children, we weren't in the space to feel them emotionally because we were shut down constantly, right? So that's the issue. Don't punish yourself for that. You've just got these emotions locked up inside of you now, and they're locked up inside of you now because the people who locked them up inside of you didn't even know how to experience their own emotions, right? So now you're making a choice to feel them. Feel them. They are all going to be old, and they're all going to be very childlike in many cases. Feel them. Let yourself experience them. When you fully experience them, you will never experience it again. Right? It's like tipping out a bottle of water, and in the end, it's empty. Right? You'll never need to experience those negative emotions again. It's only when, but what often happens in practice is we're not completely fully choosing it, right? So we deal with a bit of this and it was so painful and our soul expands a little, and then we deal with a bit more and it expands a little, and deal with a bit more and expands a little more, and it just keeps on expanding like that. And to be honest with you, it can't be an all of a sudden thing. It'd kill you, right? It would. Like, it would kill you if it was an all of a sudden thing. So let your soul, set your intention to just feel these emotions, and set your intention that you're going to do that every day, right? And you want that desire and intention to grow. Let yourself feel it. Be an emotional being from now on. Feel your passions. I'm not talking just in a negative sense either. I'm talking in a positive sense. But what do you really want to be doing now? Do you want to be doing your job now? If you don't want to be, then why are you there still? It's because of a fear, right? So deal with that fear. Let yourself feel the fear of leaving that job. Put yourself there emotionally. And let yourself feel what that's going to feel like. And go through that emotion. And you'll attract another job that you want after that, right? But every single thing you're in right now is about an emotional issue you need to deal with. So deal with it. Let yourself feel it. Experience it. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So understand, and this I want to say just in conclusion, understand that this is you. This isn't you. This isn't you. They are not you. Every time you work on these, you're not working on you. You're just working on a part, the appendage of you. You follow me? Every time you work on this, you are now working on you. You are now loving you. That is the real you. When you work on the real you and you bring your intention to just feel all of your emotions, you set that intention, what's going to happen is your emotions, because God has the same intention for you, that you feel everything, and your emotional intention is now the same as God's emotional intention, everything is just going to flow to you. Everything. Everything you need to expose every emotion in you is just going to be attracted to you on a minute-by-minute basis. And you don't need to be afraid of it. Right? Love it. It's leading you home to bliss. Yeah? And it'll be like initially it'll be like climbing this hill, you know, and it just gets steeper and steeper and you're chugging away up this hill, you know, trying to deal with all these emotions flying at you, and you just let yourself feel each one and feel each one. But you get to a point, you know, in the progression where you're starting to realize that there's hardly any emotional baggage here anymore. And everything starts to feel light now, like it starts to feel lighter and lighter and lighter. And of course that increases your momentum. And you'll find that initially it's going to be very difficult, there's going to be some very dark nights of your soul. And then as you work your way through these emotions, eventually a lot of those things will clear. And oh boy, the projection when I said that was very strong. The dark night of the soul. Many of you are very afraid of that, right? Very afraid of that. Have some deep fears about where is this going to take me. Understand that God has you in her arms. You are her precious child. and she's not going to take you anywhere where you cannot go. She's not going to take you anywhere you cannot go. She loves you and cares for you. And she wants you to experience her love. She wants you to understand what it's like in here to experience bliss. She doesn't want you to think you know. She wants you to experience it, to really feel it inside of your heart for yourself. Right? And she's going to nurse you through this whole process if you let it. And that's why I like the comment by Wayne Dyer, and I'll probably finish with this one. I've written it down, I think, somewhere in this outline. I think I've written down somewhere in the outline. Oh, yeah. Good morning. This is God. I'll be handling all of your life today. And I won't need your help. So have a good day, a miraculous day. And that's all you need to do. Like, understand that God's got everything in hand for you if you just set your intention to deal with these emotions as they come up. Just trust it. Honestly, if you set your intention just this week to try it out just once, you'll see some results with it straight away. All right. All right, well, that's the end of our session today. Do we need to say much about the next one? Really, not do we? I haven't decided the subject of the next one.
Just to make some announcements.
You do need to make some announcements? Yeah. All right. Well, thank you very much for...